get started. Is that door closed? Those doors lock when they close, and then nobody can get in. Did you lock them out?
Yeah.
Oh, so you're innocent. Okay. Before I get started, I was just going to call your attention to there's a bunch of handouts here at the end of these tables that are for your taking. There's some old back issues of Mother Earth News and Natural Farmer that are available. Acres Magazine, if you've not ever seen that, you might want to take a look through Acres Magazine. There's a couple of flyers here about the Time Exchange in Massachusetts and why do Massachusetts organic farmers oppose genetic engineering. There's a little flyer there for NOFA, Northeast Organic Farmers Organic Farmers Association websites and so on. And it's good for gardeners and farmers, not just for farmers, if you're interested in organizations. But please, either before or when you leave, help yourself to whatever's at the end of the table there. What I wanted to do today is we're going to go through sort of two topics back to back. And the first one we're going to do is just composting. And you could just pass those along. This is just sort of an outline of what we're going to do. How are you?
Cute. Very good. How are you?
Oh, you already got one?
I gave her one.
Do you want one?
Yeah.
And I'll sort of follow this outline and an outline that I have to go over composting. But you know, this is a nice sheet that actually Julia put together, and it's a nice reference material for keeping for later as well. Was hoping to do was just to kind of go through some of the basics. How many people here already compost at home in one form or another?
I just throw it in the pile.
Yeah, I mean, you probably compost whether you try to or not, if you, you know, but so you've already, do you have a bin or just a pile or, yeah, use a bin? Some kind of plastic or structural thing, homemade? Okay. So they work. Yeah, so they're black plastic, so they're recycled plastic stuff. Yeah, or you can, okay.
But it doesn't get turned. What just keep piling, and that's.
Well, that's one way of doing it. Yeah, and that works too. And we'll talk about that. What's the advantage of that? What we're really looking at is when we talk about composting, as I'm sure you can sort of appreciate, is we're really just looking at how does nature do it. Nature, as you know, does not throw anything away ever. Only human beings do that. And nature reuses it virtually everything. And everything in nature, of course, is organic. It's biodegradable. And so everything always, with the waste product of one thing or what's left over from one process becomes the nutrients for the next process. The leaves fall to the ground, they're the waste from last year and they become the nutrients for next year. And that's all we're trying to do is as most good scientists try to do, is figure how does nature do it and then how can we do it similarly and take advantage of what nature already knows and what nature has taken a few hundred million years to figure out and we can just take advantage of that. So everything we're doing is trying as best we can to replicate what's happening, what we can observe out there. A couple of points I want to make about composting. You can get really scientific about it. You can get very technical in terms of the mixtures, the carbon, the nitrogen, the pH, the temperature, the timing, and all of this stuff can get very complicated, and that's great. If you want to do that, if you enjoy doing that, then that's the way to do it, and it works very well. And if you're a commercial compost producer, producing it by the truckload, you sort of have to do it that way because you have to be careful what you don't want to, you know, tons of compost to go bad, or you don't want it to not be ready when you're ready to sell compost. You want to have everything moving properly. But if you're doing it at home, you don't really have to do it that way. All you have to do is the way it works for you. And it's almost impossible for composting to go bad. It can, or it can slow down a bit and not work as well as you would hope. But you can pretty well do it. So when we say this is what you should do, take that with a big grain of salt, because there's a lot of flexibility here and there's a lot of different ideas and different ways of doing things. So it's not rigid at all. I mean, nature does it a million different ways out there, and depending on the conditions and everything, it'll vary. One thing though that I did want to mention before we get into anything about composting is, aside from it's a good thing, it's probably the best thing you can do for your gardens and the best thing you can do for the environment is composting, taking all that organic waste out of the waste stream, and because it's not waste, it's nutrients. That, you know, this stuff, people in their kitchen, typically most people would look at this and say, oh, that's garbage. You know, that goes in the garbage. And it's not garbage. That is gold in terms of your soil is concerned. But beyond that, some people don't want to compost, they don't have the facilities, it's not convenient, so they tend to want to just go to Home Depot or go to a nursery and buy compost. As of last year, my recommendation is be really careful when you buy compost. I don't know if anybody's been following the articles. This happened to be in Mother's News, but it's been all over the place. The news about killer compost. And if you, how many people have you ever gotten compost from your local town transfer station? My transfer station where I live has a place where people can take their grass clippings, their leaves, their yard debris, and put it in piles, their Christmas trees, the whole bit, and they shred it up, and they do a really good job of composting it. And then in the spring, they put it back out, and you have these big piles of free compost for people to come with their pickup trucks and barrels and so on and take it home and put in their gardens. You don't know what people have put on their lawns. And we always sort of assumed, oh well, they put it on last year, the grass died, it's mowed, it's been composted, it's been over the winter, that was months ago, don't worry about it. Except now we find that these herbicides that people are putting on their lawns to kill broadleaf weeds are long-lived. When I say long-lived, I mean 3, 5, 10 years after they've been composted. And so what the idea of killer compost came out was, people were getting compost, mostly commercial compost, buying it from places that have been producing good compost for years, put it on their gardens and their shrubs, and everything died. The Dow Chemical and DuPont has had to withdraw some of their herbicides from the market because people are composting the debris and it's killing things. It's an herbicide and it works. It's a weed killer. And the stuff you put on lawns is to kill broadleaf plants, not grass, but broadleaf weeds. What is your garden made of? Broadleaf plants, flowers, vegetables, herbs, those are all broadleafs. Trees are broadleafs. And it's very successful at killing them. The last big episode came from my state in Vermont, where Green Mountain Compost was found that their compost was killing people's gardens. And of course they had no idea what was going on. These herbicides are not allowed in the state of Vermont unless by a certified applier. They went to their sources where they were getting their materials. Nobody was using those herbicides. And the only thing left was they were buying horse manure from a series of farms in upstate New York. They went to the farms and the farms said, no, they are not applying the herbicide to the pasture, because it's typically used on big pastures for cow to get rid of the broadleaves so they have nice just grass. No, they weren't using it either. So somebody said, but we do feed them a Purina horse chow. Well, what is that made from? They took that to the labs. Bingo, 80% of the horse chow is contaminated with herbicide. It was put on the field where the stuff was raised. It was harvested, taken to the mill by Purina, included into their horse feed pellets, and sold to the horses. The horses ate it, digested it, pooped it out. The manure was collected, sold to the compost company, and it's deadly. It's still there. All those steps that that herbicide has gone through, it's still there in high enough concentrations, much higher than is necessary to kill weeds. So, I mean, forget the poor horses that have been poisoned with this herbicide. Now people's gardens are getting it a year later down the road. So, of course, they've had to shut down that whole thing. They had to reimburse everybody for their losses and so on. So if you're, the point is, if you're buying compost, you really need to be sure of your source. And of course, there's no way you can know. If you go to Home Depot or a local nursery, it may be a very good nursery, but they don't, unless they've checked, they don't know what's in their compost. And the only way you could be sure is if you got certified organic compost, which is going to cost you more. I think Earthway in Rhode Island is certified organic. So they have to track everything they put into their compost all the way back to the feeds that the animals had.
What company is this?
Earthway.
Earthway?
They're based in Rhode Island, and they sell bulk and bagged compost.
Where you can
I've never been there.
Where?
Well, then that's the other. And then, of course, the real reason we're here is, well, wait a minute, we can just make our own and not have to worry about somebody else's herbicides setting our garden back. I used to use the town's compost at home, but I only used it on our ornamentals. I did not ever put it in the vegetable garden, which is a completely separate area. And I thought, well, if it's got a little bit of residue in it, we're just putting it on the flowers. But I won't even put it on the flowers now, because it just sets everything back. And it may be at a low enough level, depending on how much compost you put. It may not kill your plants, but maybe they'll only grow half as much as they would have and flower half as much as they would have. So why are you doing all that work to poison your own plants? It doesn't make sense.
You put it around your shrubs, you're saying? Like get rhododendron and all that stuff?
Yeah, if the herbicide's in there.
You have to screw it.
No, but the thing is, if it's that commercial compost, you don't want to even, I wouldn't. I certainly wouldn't recommend it. Well, we'll get to that. We'll get to that.
All right.
Okay, so that's the little story with killer compost. It's become a bit of a problem. Imprelis, by the way, is the name of the herbicide. Imprelis that Dow and DuPont are using. So, and you probably don't use that yourself if you use weed and feed or some kind of weed killer for your lawns. You probably don't get Imprelis, but beware of that, because if you do, you're stuck with it for many years in your garden and in your lawn and grass and everything. Okay, so we want to avoid poison compost, that's for sure, but what are the reasons why we put compost on our garden? Why is it any good? Why is it recommended?
Nutrients.
There are nutrients in compost. It's not rich in nutrients. It's not like high potency fertilizer, but it has a nice mix, depending on what you've made it with, of nutrients. The most important thing it adds, in my mind, beyond nutrients, though, is organic matter. Organic matter is the number one thing that our soils need more of. Whether you've got clay soils, sandy soils, whatever kind of soils you've got, more organic matter is better. It's always better. You just can't have too much organic matter, because organic matter stabilizes the pH. It holds water, so you don't have drought problems and dehydration problems. It inhibits the growth of disease organisms, plant diseases, is what we're talking about, in the soil, so it blocks them. And it also attracts beneficials to the soil. You get more earthworms if you've got compost in your soil. You get more beneficial nematodes if you've got compost. So it brings in all the good guys, and it keeps the bad diseases in check, simply because it's setting up a very complex ecosystem in your soil. So it's not just dirt. It's an ecosystem. It's a living ecosystem is what you're trying to support there.
Stabilizes what?
The pH, the acidity of the soil. And you can, you know, if your soil is a little acidic, you might want to add wood ashes or lime or something. But if you can also just add compost. If your soil is really acidic, you might want to add some lime and then compost, and the compost will hold the pH where you want it. It doesn't allow the pH to go up or down. It keeps it near neutral, where it should be, somewhere between 6 and 7. Okay, how do we do it? And this is part of Julia's outline here. The first thing is you want to select a site to put your compost. And everybody's site is going to be different, but there's a couple basic points you want to remember. Don't put it where in a wet spot. And it's a very big temptation. Well, there's that low wet spot over there. I'll put it over there because I can't do anything else over there. That's a bad idea because then you've got waterlogged compost and it won't rot very well. It'll get anaerobic, it'll smell, and it won't decay properly. So pick a nice spot that has good drainage. The key thing is think of yourself. Put it where it's convenient for you to get to. Because if it's a big job to take your stuff out to the compost pile every day, then you're going to get tired of it after a while. And if it's a big job to get the compost from the bin or the pile to the garden, you're going to put it off and delay it and not do it like you should. So think of yourself. Think of where will it be easy for me to dump from the house or the grass clippings and so on, and where is it going to be easy for me to get it to the garden? And for everybody, that's going to be a little different. Might be near your house, it might be near the garden, it might be somewhere in between. Maybe your garden's all the way around the house, so then you have to figure, well, where's the easiest place to bring the grass clippings and leaves and so on, and find a convenient spot. The idea is you want to make life easy for yourself. Don't set it up so now it becomes a chore. Think about where you want. And of course, you can always move it. It's not like it's bolted to the ground or anything. So you can always change this if you have to.
In a shady area, is that all right?
Shady is not the best. Mine's in the shade. I have one in the shade and one in the sun. And a shade won't stop it from working, but it will be cooler. Especially in the wintertime, it'll tend to be colder and freeze up.
So
well, then you put something in front of it. That
so what's the blocks. Best?
Sunny. Sunny spot is the best. But sometimes a sunny spot isn't, you know, where you want to put it because it's right where you want to have your garden or where everybody will see it. And compost bin isn't really that ugly, but again, it's not a landscape feature that you want to show off necessarily either. You know, well, I mean, paint your outhouse a nice color, then put some flowers in front of it.
Yeah,
I'm getting an outhouse with the crescent moon and everything as a tool shed, but it looks like an outhouse.
I like that idea.
just a little tool shed to keep things right next to the garden. You can set up your compost pile as just a pile, and that's fine. That's the way nature does it. But sometimes if we have a yard or an area, you might want to contain it a little bit. I've had problems with my compost where my neighbor's pigs get into it. And so I have to have some kind of container in addition to a fence to keep the pigs out. Otherwise, all I'm doing is fattening the neighbor's pigs. And it doesn't matter what I put in there, pigs are happy to eat it. So you kind of have to think of your local situation, whether you want to have, there are bins that, you know, are made like this, some are round, some are square. Quite a few towns subsidize compost bins, so you can get that through the town health department, because it's in the town's interest to cut back on the amount of garbage, organic matter, that people are taking to the landfill. That stuff is heavy, and you have to pay by the pound to have it hauled away someplace. And so they would really prefer people keep that at home, just for economic reasons. But you should want to keep it to home. And I never can understand this, how many people I see, particularly in the fall, raking up their leaves, carefully putting them into plastic bags, and lugging them off to the dump, as though it's something bad to have around. And where are you going with that stuff? That's like raking up money and carrying it away. You know, they just aren't thinking about what they're doing. And then on the way home, they'll stop at Home Depot and buy a bag of fertilizer put on the lawn. And I say, well, you just carried all the nutrients that the trees made for you away, and now you're bringing in stuff made out of petroleum to put on your lawn. That just doesn't make sense. So the whole idea is you're helping yourself all along. But so you put it either in a bin, and think about how you're going to do it, because some of the bins are fine, they're durable, but they're kind of hard to turn. I have a couple of bins that the top is okay, you can get it open, and it latches so that raccoons and wind and so on doesn't open it up on me. And it has a bottom door, a hatch. So rather than turn it so much, and I do turn it with a pitchfork, but I can open the bottom hatch and take out the compost that's near the bottom, which is usually almost ready to go. And that makes it easier than have to dig into a barrel and, you know, scoop it out with a shovel. That can be a real pain to try to get it out. So think about, how is this thing really going to work? And don't get yourself one of these compost bins that looks real pretty, but it's all kind of enclosed and it's got a small top. Think about, how are you going to work with that? That's going to be very inconvenient. The ones we have here on campus are just made out of scrap concrete bumpers from parking lots. And so we have big three-sided bins. You can do that with wood, or you can do it with concrete blocks, you can do it with hay bales, and just make three-sided bins. You can make them almost any size you want. They should be at least 2 or 3 feet across to have enough mass to make it worthwhile. But any kind of material, wooden pallets work well, chicken wire with fence posts so that it's nice and open and ventilated. All that is doing is keeping things from blowing away and things from getting into it. And, you know, if you're putting kitchen scraps in there, there'll probably be raccoons around or possums that might want to go in there. I don't worry about rodents getting in so much. If mice and so on get in, they're just going to go in there and eat some and poop some. So that's really just adding to the process. And
you do get rats.
So I haven't seen rats around mine. The advantage, of course, of the bins is rodents can't really get in, because they have a bottom and they come up, and it's made so that they really can't easily get in there. Even squirrels or raccoons can't get in, because it latches pretty well. And if you keep it latched, I'm worried more about the wind blowing the top off, and then it rains and gets everything too wet. If you have an open pile or an open three-sided bin, you should cover it. Otherwise, you'll end up with, you get a couple of rainy days, it'll be too waterlogged. And you want to kind of restrict the amount of water that gets into it so it doesn't get too wet, and then it gets anaerobic. You don't get enough oxygen, the water squeezes out all the air, and then the thing sits there and kind of starts to smell bad, and it doesn't decay well. So you can decide what kind of container you want and what's convenient for you, and they all work. It's just a matter of convenience, preference, how much you want to pay, that kind of thing. What do you put into the compost? All organic matter rots. So it's essentially everything that's organic can go into a compost pile. Those paper towels, your newspaper, your Kleenex that you blew your nose with, the newspapers, the kitchen scraps. One thing, of course, everybody thinks coffee grounds are good for compost, but then I've seen people, and I brought these along just to, this is my last 2 days collection at home. We're still eating butternut squash from last summer.
Oh, wow.
But this one had a bad end. Coffee grounds. Oh, but what about the paper filter? Is that organic? Of course. That's perfectly good. I just dumped the whole thing in. I mean, that paper is pretty flimsy stuff anyway. It's going to decay pretty quickly. Tea bags, the paper. Yes, the tag, the string. It's all organic. You know, there's a little staple in there. I guess that probably won't rot, but that's okay. Eggshells. Eggshells won't really rot and disappear on you, but if you crunch them all up, some people, I don't know if you do it, or some people I know dry them.
Yeah.
If you have an oven with a pilot light, or if you're really slick and you have one of the new ovens that has the, because we don't have pilot lights in our gas stoves anymore, but what's that process of keeping something really just at a low temperature, like for bread to rise?
Oh.
What's that called?
Warming tray.
Well, yes, it's like warming,
it's
like, but there's like a term for it.
There is a
culinary term for. Like making you
proofing,
that's it. Proofing. If you have a proofing oven, because they're now coming out with proofing ovens, because they realize people miss the old idea of a warm oven that's, you know, very much lower than 200 degrees. If you have a proofing oven, put your eggshells in there or anywhere, and then they'll pulverize very easily. But if not, when we crack them and throw them in here, we just kind of crunch them in our fingers and break them into smaller pieces. They will come out at the end of your compost. When your compost is finished and it's ready to go to the garden, you'll see pieces of eggshells still in there. That's okay. They're not going to decay that fast, but they are slowly releasing calcium into the soil all the time, and some nitrogen and some other nutrients, some other minerals. So just break them up so that they spread around, and you'll see fragments of eggshells everywhere. They don't cause any harm. And that's just a long-term investment in your soil, because they're going to continue to add to it. Banana peels, squash, vegetables, fruit, citrus, and anything I put in, I tend to like to slice it up or cut it smaller so it will decay faster, more thoroughly. Now, this was sliced for the worms, but banana peels.
Would there be any point in
cutting them up
in a blender?
It would help, but I don't think it's necessary.
But then it's liquid.
Yeah, I mean, then you've got to wash the blender, and if you want to do that every day, I mean, the amount of effort that we have, the thing is, you want to make it convenient so you do it as a regular daily activity. If you start to make it too complicated and too burdensome, you're going to get tired of it, or else nobody else in your house is going to do it. We have one of these on the kitchen counter. I have one like this, and I have one that's tall, or it's even got a little charcoal filter in the top. But it comes with a cover, and it keeps fruit flies down. It comes with a little handle in the back, so you can, you know, you dump it. Oops, sorry. I just washed it out. That's why there's water on it. And because I had rinsed it over there after I scrubbed it this morning. And you just keep the fruit flies off, out of it that way, and keep, you know, in case, it does have a little bit of an odor of things if they're sitting there for a day or two, especially in the summertime. And then you just take it out and dump it every day or two, or whenever it gets full. But you want to make it easy for yourself. Don't make it, you know, a problem. And find a place that, as I say, there's some are very beautiful. You know, Garden Supply Company sells these things for $30 or $40. They look like little milk cans, and they're ceramic, and they're all the colors, and they're chrome, and, you know, great. If you've got the money to pay for that, and that's important to you, then go for it. This is what came with our compost bin from the town. I think we paid $5 or $10 with, dollars for it. Pardon?
What town?
Bourne. We don't live in Bourne, but a friend does.
I just wanted to know if it was a town that I could get free one from.
Oh, they usually don't have them free, but they're very heavily subsidized. So if those bins, let's say, sell for $90, they sell them for $30. So it's a subsidized price because it's worth it to them to get that stuff out of the waste stream. You just have to call the health department. Okay, and they sell them, yeah. And it's a great, it makes sense. The other little side point I was going to mention with this, particularly in the winter time, banana peels and so on, you'll get fruit flies. And people say, oh, I just can't stand it. There's fruit flies. And you open it up, and of course, if you leave it open, then they're all around. Well, fruit flies, of course, don't hurt anything. They're not going to bite you or spread disease or anything like that. But they're a little bit, oh, they're cute. They have red eyes. Look at them closely. But it's so easy to build a fruit fly trap to control them. I have a little issue with fruit flies around the worm bin as well. I have two worm bins at home, and but it's so easy. You take a little glass, like a shot glass or a juice glass or something like that, put a half an inch of vinegar in it. You put a drop of dish soap, just a drop, don't put a lot, just a drop of dish soap, and kind of swirl that around, and it'll, you know how soap will form a film on the top? That just breaks the surface tension. The vinegar attracts the fruit flies. They come in, land, they can't get out of it because of the soap on the surface. They can't float. They sink and drown. And you put that out in a week, you'll have 50 fruit flies.
Does it matter? Can it be plastic? Can it be a glass?
Whatever will hold vinegar, okay. As long as it, you know, I wouldn't use a paper cup because it might eventually leak on you. But anything plastic or glass. And if you really have a lot of fruit flies and you want to get them fast, put a few drops of red wine in the vinegar. I put that in and bam, it was like I turned and walked away and they were already going into it before I got 10 feet away from it. But normally it'll take them a while to start. And I just set that on the counter near, you know, somewhere where it won't get tipped over and bumped or anything. And it's just open. Of course, you can go to Gardener Supply and you can pay $30 for a fruit fly trap if you want to do that. And you can buy their refills too if you want to do that. Or you can buy a gallon of vinegar and you'll have a fruit fly trap for the rest of your life for almost nothing with a drop of soap.
What kind of vinegar?
I use cider vinegar. Yeah, the apple cider vinegar. And it works really well. And you know, if you've got a big bloom of fruit flies because you had a bunch of bananas on the counter, because you bring fruit flies in from the supermarket, that's where they come from. Wherever you buy your fruit, the eggs are on the fruit when you buy it. So one way you can cut back on fruit flies in your house is wash all the fruit when you bring it home. If you wash it all off, you'll get those eggs off if you want to do that. But otherwise, just set out a trap. And it's we have two traps going, one in the kitchen and one where the worm bin is. And they're just constantly get, every week I freshen them. And there's always a pile of dead fruit flies in the bottom.
So are you saying that if you do this composting, you will automatically get fruit flies?
Probably. Depending on what, I mean, if you're putting in fruit peelings and vegetables and banana peels and whatnot, fruit flies will come in. I mean, you're going to bring the fruit flies yourself from the store.
So
and then you're just giving a place for them to feel.
As soon as you peeled it, take it out.
If you do that, yeah. If you're that meticulous and you've got the time to do that every time, then that will do it. You know, I mean, maybe you could just open your kitchen window and throw it out the window, you know, if you got a pile right there. Again, you want to make it easy for yourself so that you end up doing it. Because what I hate to see is people try to make these things so complicated and so technical that after 2 or 3 weeks they're tired of it and they just don't follow through. Just make it easy and do it the easy way that works. Okay. What can you put in? Well, you really want to have a mix. And I said there's these greens and browns, which is carbon and nitrogen. You want to have 30 parts carbon to one part nitrogen, roughly. But
how do you know which is which?
Well, things that are, this is all green stuff. This
so is
nitrogen stuff.
Nitrogen?
That's nitrogen. This is nitrogen. And you'll see a list there in that table.
Browns,
there's a suggested
green.
List. Browns would tend to be just what they are. You know, like green grass cuttings are green. So you don't want to have just green grass cuttings. You want to mix it with some browns. And you can run them over with a lawnmower to chop them up a little bit if you want to, or not. If you chop them up a little bit, they'll break down faster. If you don't, they'll break down slower. Depends on how big a hurry you're in. Paper is great. You can tear up paper by hand. If you have a shredder, a lot of people have shredders at home now. Well, you can see what's in there. Shredded paper. That's perfectly good. That's made from plant material, right? That's made from trees. I'm sorry?
Ink in newspaper.
It's not a problem anymore. It's soy ink now. They don't use the lead-based colored ink that they used to have. I would not probably put into my compost glossy paper things.
Which?
Glossy, colored with colored paper. Like ads that you get, the ads, the inserts that come in newspapers and stuff that have glossy paper with real bright color pictures and so on. I don't put those in. You're not even supposed to burn those in your wood stove because of the fumes that come off of them. I don't put that in. But everything else in terms of newspapers, paper towels, Kleenexes, I mean, you could put toilet paper in. Anything that's, it's all organic. It's all made from plants and trees. Just like these leaves are. Paper is no more than leaves, really. It's the same process, the same material. And all of that should go in there.
When it says manure, whose?
Well, anybody's except yours. And the only issue with your manure and with, and don't take this personally, with yours or say your dogs or your cats, is they're carnivores for the most part, and they also carry diseases and parasites that can be transmitted between them and you and them. And it's probably not a problem, but just to be on the safe side, we generally suggest people not use human manure or pet manure, cats and dogs.
What about rabbits?
Great. Absolutely great stuff. Chickens, rabbits, chickens.
Chickens?
Parakeets, parrots. All of those are great sources of high nitrogen and phosphate. Very good sources, yeah.
So if you had a parrot, you could use that?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Any bird?
Sure, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you're not going to get that much. It might seem like a lot because you have to clean the cage all the time, but you're not going to get buckets like you would with a chicken coop or something. But yeah, all of that. So it's probably, and you can see on the list here, there's a list of suggested things, and you can think of other things.
What about the seeds? Are seeds something that you don't want to get in?
Seeds?
Yeah.
Like what? Like what?
Watermelon seeds.
Oh, let them grow. Why not? What's the problem? They're easy enough to. You're going to turn it and you're going to spread it, and they're probably not going to go. And don't forget, like that rice that went bad in the refrigerator, the leftover rice or the pasta, the macaroni, spaghetti, cereal, any oats or wheat or corn
things. Yeah, but if
things,
it's been mixed with cheese sauce or.
Oh well, then you got a different issue. But there's not a problem with it. It's organic.
What about if it's mixed with butter on it or something?
It's organic. It's not
can
a problem.
You put cheese in there?
Sure. We've had moldy cheese, like you get a bag of that shredded cheese and then you forget about it and it gets in the back and you pull that out and it's all this beautiful blue and green all over it. And you decide probably not
so
even to feed it to the dog. Put it in the compost.
Cheese from an animal can go in the compost.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, if you have an open pile and it's near the neighbor's dogs and cats, you probably wouldn't want to do that because it will attract them to it if they smell it. But if it's in a bin, why not? I mean, farmers put whole animals in their compost piles. I know there's one farm near here, I won't mention who she is, but we went by her compost pile. She had several compost piles, big piles on the farm. And she says, oh yeah, and that's the pile where we put the bodies. And she just casually kept on walking and everybody's like, wait a minute, what? The bodies? Where do you get them from, New Jersey or something? What do you mean, wait a minute, stop here. What do you mean the bodies? Oh, she says, oh, I meant the chickens. sometimes the chicken dies, or a piglet dies, and we just...
Yeah, but if you don't know what it died of, you didn't do an autopsy, then could you poison or affect...
Maybe. It probably died of something abnormal if it died, but they just dig a hole, put it down in the hole, and bury it. I mean, you're going to bury it someplace anyway, right? You're probably going to bury it, put it, what's the difference if you put it in a hole in the ground? It's going to decay in the ground. Things are going to, bacteria and fungi and worms are going to eat it up anyway and spread whatever is in there. I mean, unless you're taking it to the incinerator or something, it's still going out into your environment one way or the other. At least this way they know where it goes. Hair is fine. I used to have hair to put in the compost. You can go to the barber shop, or if you brush out your dog or cat or something like that, it's all organic. It all goes in. Use your imagination. If it's organic, if it comes from plant or animal.
What if you treat your dog with flea treatment?
Well, you've got all kinds of complications. Eh? What kind of flea treatment? The collar? The drop you put there?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's systemic. That goes into their body. That goes into their bloodstream.
So what's the answer to that one?
I don't think it's much in their hair. We use it. I save my hair, my dog's hair, separately because I use it in mesh bags out around the garden for the smell of the hair. Keep deer and bear away from things. I have a lot of problems with bear getting into my hives.
Bear?
Yeah.
Where do you live?
Vermont? Yeah.
Anyway, near St. Johnsbury?
Not that far. That's way up there.
Do you commute every day?
Huh?
Do you commute every day?
No.
Yeah. I drive really fast. No, just weekends. Just long weekends.
So you're here during the week?
Yeah.
And there on the weekend?
Yeah.
I like West.
And all summer. And all Christmas.
Beautiful.
Whenever I can be. Yeah. But it's a choice. The other ingredient to mention, though, with compost, so you've got all the solid stuff. You can put in your grass clippings, your leaves, and leaves and grass clipping combined, like in the fall when the leaves fall on the grass, please don't rake your leaves. Just mow them. You know, that's if you have a lawnmower and you have that much lawn, just mow the leaves and the grass at the same time, and then go over it with a bagger if you want, because you may have a lot. Bag it all up. That's a perfect mix for compost. It's a mixture of the green grass and the brown leaves, already mixed up and chopped up for you. That's perfect compost. All the other stuff you can add in, but two other things that we often overlook is water and air. Don't forget, to have a good process going to break down, there needs to be air in there. So when you build the pile, you want to keep it fluffy and maybe mix it with a pitchfork every few weeks and keep it moist. The moisture of this, not dripping wet, you can't squeeze water out of it, and it shouldn't be powdery dry. This is a little bit dry now, but it should be like a wet sponge type moisture, because the bacteria move around in there in the water. And they need water to live, just like you and I do. And they need air.
Then the top should be open.
No.
The rain can get in.
No, because then you can get too much rain and too much water.
Just leave it in. Mine's open.
This goes in. This is worms.
I said mine's open.
You add the water. You control how much water goes in.
So do you have holes on the sides?
For drain, the whole bottom is mesh, so it can drain. And there are ventilation holes on the side. Usually slits. The ones you buy, they have slits or holes or something to kind of let air in. Some people will, when you're starting, put twigs and sticks and brush on the bottom and then put things on top of that, and that keeps kind of a looser area at the bottom so air can get in underneath and work its way up through. If you want to be meticulous about it, they'll say, well, you need to mix it every 2 weeks. Okay, that's great. If you can mix it every 2 weeks, you've got the energy and the interest, and you mix it every 2 weeks, you'll be fine. It'll work faster, it'll decay faster, and it'll go well. But if you feel like you've got to do it every 2 weeks, you're going to get kind of discouraged after a while. If you can mix it, mix it. Sometimes I mix it every month. Sometimes it's 2 months. sometimes it's a couple of times. In the spring, I'll tend to mix it more because it's early and I've got more energy in the spring. But and I want to get things going because it's been dormant all winter. But mix it when you can. The more, the better. If you don't mix it at all, it'll still rot. It's just going to be much slower.
And why did you say it's going to be dormant in the winter? Is that because it's
cold? Frozen solid.
It's frozen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And now some people will talk about hot compost and cold compost. They both work. Hot compost means you're mixing it every 2 weeks. You're real careful with your carbon-nitrogen ratios. And hot compost has the advantage of getting up to a high enough temperature that it will kill weed seeds, it'll kill a lot of pathogens, and it'll make for a very healthy compost. It has the disadvantages you lose a lot more nutrients out of it. Hot compost isn't as nutritious as cold compost. And with hot compost, to really get a good hot compost pile, you need to build the whole thing at once with layers. And you get it started and it goes. What most people really do though is you start a compost pile, and then every week you keep adding to it. It's like constantly feeding. That's going to be a cold pile. It might heat up once in a while, but generally it's going to be a cooler pile, and it's going to be slower. And it's not going to pasteurize or kill weed seeds that are in there or kill pathogens, but it's going to conserve a lot more nutrients. So it has the advantage of being more nutritious. The hot compost is less nutritious but has cleaned out the weed seeds, if you've got weeds in there. I don't think I add a lot of weed stuff to my pile anyway, so it probably isn't an issue, but some people might if they, you know, have that.
Well, if you just put just that, like you might think it's just that.
Well, it's that, but it's also leaves, grass clippings, flower cuttings, bush trimmings.
But in the winter, it's just that.
Yeah. My wife buys flowers all the time. So we have all the dead flowers off the table, and a lot of stuff like that goes in. It's whatever you have. Yeah, and that's fine. If this is all you're putting in all winter long is this kind of thing, I usually have next to my compost bin, in the fall, I rake up a pile of leaves and I put it right next to it. So that when I put this in, when I start to get, you know, sort of a solid mass of kitchen stuff, I'll reach in and I'll put a pile of leaves in to make a layer of brown leaves. Sort of cover it. And then you start adding kitchen on top of that, so you mix it. But you have to do that in the fall when the leaves are, you know, available.
Or shredded paper.
Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Yeah, and kind of mix the carbon. You need to get some more carbon in there so it doesn't get...
Brown is the carbon.
Yeah. Paper is carbon. Brown is carbon. Green is wet stuff. Fresh stuff and wet stuff. Just like on this list. I'm trying to move quickly because I know some people may have to leave. Turning it, I talked about. When is it ready? Well, it's kind of ready when you are, but somewhere between 6 weeks and 6 months. If you've got a hot compost pile, it might be 4 to 6 weeks and it's ready to go out. But most people are going to have a intermittent hot pile and mostly a cool pile. It might be 4 to 6 months before it's really black and rich and ready to be used.
It's ready.
You look at it, and when it doesn't look like this anymore, and you can't recognize what's in it. So when you take a shovel full out, and you can't recognize the ingredients that you put in, because they're broken down so much, there may be chunks of things and pieces of things, but they're no longer recognizable.
You recognize the eggshells.
You'll see eggshells probably. If you had corn cobs, you'll see corn cobs. They won't break down very fast. If you use citrus, if you put orange peels and stuff, they'll still be there because they're very slow to break down. Just leave them. Put them in the ground and they'll be slow release. It's essentially when you can no longer recognize what you put in easily. And it should look well. Here it is. This is what it should look. I mean, this is when it's really well done.
Can I touch it?
Of course. It's compost. It's healthy. Just don't eat it. It's too expensive. It should smell like wet earth. It shouldn't smell like anything putrid or rotten or bad. You know, it should just smell like wet earth.
Yeah, it's just like a real rich dirt.
A lot of organic matter. And that will attract worms, that will attract beneficials, and it will do all the things that compost is supposed to do. Pardon?
Stabilize, I wrote things down.
And you can't buy anything that good in the store, at any price, in any store. You can't buy.
How about vermiculite?
I use vermiculite in the soil that I use to start seedlings. I don't add it to compost. It's too expensive. That's pretty expensive stuff. And the role of vermiculite is to kind of aerate the soil and lighten it. And I'm not particularly concerned about the weight or density of the compost.
Could you plant seeds in that?
Oh yeah. Well, if I were going to use this for my seedlings, and I do, I mix starter soil, seed starter soil, with this 50-50. And that gives them enough nutrients to get going. When plants first get started, they don't really need nutrients because they've got their seed with nutrients to get them started for the first week or so of life. Once you transplant those little seedlings into little cells or pots, then I use this kind of soil, half and half of this.
Question.
Yeah.
When you use the leaves, you differentiate among the different types of leaves?
No.
About oak leaves, and I thought those were...
No. Oak and maple and elm and black locust and whatever is there is there. That's the way nature does it. She doesn't pick things out separate. And there's all kinds of tannins and acids and so on from different leaves. And pine needles are great. If you've got pine needles, don't forget those. Those are great mulch and great for composting.
Are pine needles still considered brown?
Yes. Yeah. And they do not acidify the soil. They do not acidify the compost. That's a fallacy that people have just sort of, everybody says it, so everybody thinks it must be true. It's not true.
How about clippings from yews and spruce?
Yeah, yeah.
All that's good.
Sure, yeah, yeah. And if it's, you know, if it's got woody limbs, you might want to chop them up. The smaller you can chop them up, the better. Put the stems, if you've got stems and branches, if you're doing a new compost pile, put those at the bottom and to sort of help keep it lifted and aerated.
Oak leaves don't decay very well.
They're slower, yeah. But they're very good for the soil. There was oak leaves in there.
There was.
They're gone. Yeah, they're slower. I mean, obviously slower than, say, brown paper or poplar leaves or something like that. Yeah, they're tougher. They have more tannins in them. But they contribute to the soil just like any other leaf. And I think it's good to have the more you mix, the more different kinds of nutrients you'll get, the longer release. You don't want your stuff to just all of a sudden rot really fast and then release the nutrients all at once. You want some things rot fast, some things rot slower, and some things take a long time. The advantage of adding compost to your soil is this is going to benefit the soil for a couple of years. It's not like, you know, 10, 10, 10, you put it down and half a month later, it's gone down into the watershed. This stuff will be there for a couple of years. And of course, I add it a couple of times a year, so I keep trying to build it up, but it's a long-term benefit, slow release.
If you start this in the spring, get it going through, let's say, November, is it good to put it in November? Put it on top?
Yeah.
The spring.
There's different points of view about when to fertilize and when to compost, apply it, and so on. Some plants you want to put it on while they're growing, just as they start to make their big vegetative growth, like with, say, tomatoes or peppers and so on. Give them that extra feed. Plus, of course, this is going to hold the moisture, so it's adding protection from drying out in the summertime. So I like to add it as a side dressing during the growing time, as well as in the beginning when I put compost in the holes when I transplant. Every tomato plant gets a scoop of compost in the hole. It's not going to burn anything. It goes right in the hole. I just kind of mix it around with the dirt real quick. I use something, not this one, but something like this, just to kind of, you know, mix it in with the soil a little bit, because I usually add that. I add some bone meal and eggshells. A banana peel is great to put in the hole for tomatoes, and mix that all in and cover them, pack them, and they're good to go.
Epsom salts also.
Yeah, yeah, for boron. Yeah, for boron, particularly with brassicas like cauliflower and broccoli and kohlrabi and kale and all of those. It's very good for them. The last thing I wanted to mention about tea compost is making tea. You take your mature compost that you've had out of your bin that's ready to use. And one of the best things you can do with that is take a small shovel full of it. If you've got like a 5-gallon bucket, put a 5-gallon bucket, put a small shovel full, not a big scoop, but would be like maybe a quart, say, worth, in the bucket and fill it up with water, fresh water. So you've got 3 or 4 gallons of fresh water in there. Stir it around. Now this is something you want to do a couple of times a day. Stir it and keep it agitated. If you want to get really technical about it, you'll buy an aquarium pump and you'll put a hose and you'll have a bubbler and you'll have it going 24 hours a day. And that's good. That'll work and that's best. But short of that, get a stick and stir it. And just kind of get it all stirred up every once in a while. And of course, what you're making is compost tea. Not to serve to your guests, but that tea then, what you're really doing is you're leaching out a few of the nutrients out of the compost. But more importantly, what's actually happening, and the reason you want to keep mixing it, is to keep oxygen in the water, is the bacteria that are in here, the beneficial bacteria and fungi, are exploding in numbers with that water. Just exploding in numbers. So now what you're doing is you're not just putting compost on the plants, you're putting an amplified number of the microbes that are in compost out there. This is a terrific thing to do in the springtime because the soil has been dormant now for a few months. All the microbes, the earthworms are starting to get active now, but all the microbes are pretty slow at this point, this time of the year. And if you want to get things going easier and quicker, in the spring, as soon as we start to get some decent weather, put some compost tea on. And that just inoculates your soil with all the right bacteria and gets them going.
From the time that you have the barrel, you add the scoop, you fill it up with water, you stir every
1 to 2 days.
What?
1 to 2 days. You must use compost tea fresh. Yeah. Don't make it and then figure, okay, I'm too busy, I'm going to do it next week. Well, okay, put it on your plants, but you've lost the benefit because the bacteria will die back. You get an explosion of bacteria in the water, but then they will quickly overpopulate the water and die back. So you want to get that out on the plant. Put it on the leaves if you've got plants there, if you've got perennials or shrubs or flowers in the summertime. Put it all over the leaves because those bacteria then are going to fight off diseases that are going to try to get into your plants as well as activating the soil. Yeah, like you think of a 5-gallon bucket?
Yeah, and how much compost?
You wouldn't, maybe half this much of what's in here. You don't need that much. Because all you're doing is, and then of course you use that compost, just dump it out someplace too. But all you're doing is using this as a starter, as a source of bacteria, and that water is going to just explode. I've been doing something with that compost tea that I have no scientific reason to believe it really works, but I just feel it's got to help, is when I put the water in, I get the compost going, I put in a tablespoon or two of fish emulsion. For extra nutrients, because of the micronutrients, just to kind of give it a little bit more pizzazz, you know, food for the bacteria. Fish emulsion, the fertilizer, fish fertilizer.
So 1 tablespoon?
Yeah, just a small amount, like a tablespoon. Out. Yeah, not much, just to dilute.
How many cups of that compost?
A quart. What, like four cups or so? A quart, yeah. And I just put in the fish emulsion. It just makes me feel good. It seems like, well, I'll just feed the bacteria a little bit more, just to sort of maybe. I've never done a count. You know, somebody should do a microscopic count and see, well, does it really help or not? In the end, if it doesn't help, the fish emulsion is going on the garden anyway, so it's not like it's wasted. It's going to get applied. But what you're really trying to do is up the beneficial microbes in the soil by doing the tea. And you can apply compost tea every 2 weeks all summer long if you really want to be interested in it. We do it a couple of times in the spring, a couple of times during the summer. Not as much as probably it should, but it's one more thing to do, you know. And you, the best time to do anything in the garden, the rule of thumb, you know, when the best time to do anything is when you've got time to do it. So when they say pruning, fertilizing, planting, all that, there's all these rules of when you're supposed to do things. But the bottom line is, do it when you can, and you never often. You're always, you know, late or early, and you just do it when you can. So you do this. I think the important thing of putting on compost tea as well as fish emulsion, if you're doing that, is to do it early in the morning. Because if you do it in the afternoon, a lot of the stuff will just dry off real quickly in the sun, and you'll lose the bacteria. They'll die in the sun. The sun is very sterilizing. The ultraviolet rays will kill things there. So do it early in the morning. I don't say in the evening, because then the plants will stay wet into the night, and that can promote bacteria or diseases. So put it on early in the morning, gets a chance to soak in the shade before the sun is up and hot, and the leaves will dry off through the day, and you get all the benefit from it that way. So it's a morning job to do, just like watering is a morning job to do. Well, we've pretty well blown an hour, and we haven't even gotten to part two. Does anybody have any questions about composting? Or any other ideas, things that I missed that you think you want to add?
Real quickly, I have two composters going continuously. One for this year, and the other one, once that gets to its maximum filled up, then I start the next one the next year. Mm-hmm. And so that they alternate year in, year out. And at the end of the year, I sift it out. So yep. I end up with a nice compost like you have there. But
yeah.
Sift it, because there's always a few twigs and stones.
Yeah, there's always chunks, a few stones and everything.
And that's still organic. It gets dumped into the one that's ongoing.
Yeah.
Then start the next one.
And sifting is great. I mean, you just use a hardware cloth, like quarter inch or 3/8 inch cloth and a 2x4 frame or something.
Yep.
But if you don't, it's okay too. I mean, you have chunks of things going.
Everything's okay.
You know, if you're going to use it for seed starting, then you sifting it would really be helpful, because you like a nice, fine, lightweight material. But other than that, I mean, you can go through here, I'm sure you'll find there's little sticks and things in there. They'll go into the ground, and they'll just continue to rot. And there's no eggshells in here for some reason, but usually there would be all kinds of fragments of eggshells and stuff. What should we do? I've got the stuff here for a worm bin. How many people, we have the room, we can stay a little longer if you want to just, what I thought I would do is, I mean, all worm bin vermiculture is another level of composting. And I like it because you can do it in the winter time. The worm, my worm bin, should I tell them? It's in my dining room. near the back door by the slide, with sliding glass doors. But I have one that's from Gardenway. They had them on sale once, and I grabbed one. It looks like a little end table, almost. So people look at it, and they have, because it's got little legs and stuff, they look at it and say, oh, that's a nice little bookcase. And, well, it's, let me show you what's inside.
Yeah.
And there's like thousands of worms just suddenly shoot off in every direction when you
is
take the cover off.
Is that warm? Is that why? Like,
yeah, because it's warm inside. If you put it outside, they're going to freeze.
So the
compost being outside is okay with, because it's full of worms too, but they go down in the ground in the wintertime.
Okay.
And this, these guys, they can't go anywhere.
What's the coldest they can tolerate?
40, probably. You start seeing earthworm activity around 40 when the soil temperature is about 40.
If you do it in a cell, it would be okay.
Sure, it would be cool. Yeah, as long as they don't freeze solid, because they have nowhere to go in a bin. They're, you know, they're captive, and if they freeze, they're dead. You know, but
they don't come up.
But the advantage is you can keep stuff breaking down. But what you get out of a worm bin is, of course,
big for trout season.
Well, yeah, you get that too.
but
you get the compost, you get worm poop.
Yeah.
Yeah, but does what you put in there generate heat for the worms?
No.
Like
you don't want it generating heat. That would be uncomfortable.
Cool?
That would be uncomfortable. The worms don't want heat. And they'll move. If you get this thing going where it heats up, you'll see worms coming out. They'll escape because that heat can be too rough on them. But this is a very simple worm bin. There's all kinds of them. And here.
You
don't have to Google it. It's right here. On the back page is a list of references. Right at the top of the first page, I put Ben's bins, not because I'm trying to sell his bins at all, but he's the one who provided some of this information. So, and I like his bins. He's a nice guy, and he's doing
this. Where did you put this?
Pardon?
I didn't hear what you said, but where I'm finding whoever this worm.
Ben's bins, right on the front page, just his name. And there's a website. We have worms. And if you look at his picture on his website, don't tell him I said this, but he actually kind of looks like a worm, which is a compliment, I think. You know, wormy references. There's a whole bunch of websites and stuff for getting worms, for getting bins. There's lots of information on them about raising them. But as you can see from this is very simple. It's got these tubes that go from side to side, so the air can get into the bottom. And do you have time to, we can just set this one up? I mean, everything is right here, so I could just go quickly through what you want to do is you want to have bedding for them. And the same things go into the worm bin that go into a compost pile, essentially. So these are leaves that actually collected in my trailer over the winter, in the fall, and I chopped them up a bit. And all I'm doing is I'm just putting those in as bedding for the worms.
I thought you used coconut husk.
You can. Coir is very good. You buy that coir, C-O-I-R. It looks like a big brick. And you put that in a bucket with water, and you won't believe how much material you'll get out of that brick. You think you're paying, oh, geez, I have to pay $3 for this little block of stuff? That's not a very good buy. It's a good buy. Any place that sells it. You can buy it online. Nurseries and greenhouses are starting to sell it now. I think it's preferable to sphagnum or peat moss because it doesn't require the destruction of wetlands. To make it, sphagnum and peat moss requires the destruction of wetlands to make it, to dig it up because it's dug up and then the wetlands is destroyed. I'm just throwing this stuff in. Boy, this is a good shredder.
Those are all our country's top secrets.
Yeah, this we got this from the CIA.
I'm going to all the stuff that I'm kind of high here.
So we just put. It's the same. I mean, the paper or the leaves, both, one, or it's not like you need two. The coir is good. You just put that in there. And all you're giving the worms is someplace to hold the moisture. They don't like light. They want to go down inside. And I'm just mixing it in. And, you know, we can, I don't know how full you want this, we can mix it up so it's up higher and fill it up more. Another thing, a few sticks, that's okay. The other thing you want to put in your worm bin is this happens to be beach sand. Worms are predators, as it says in there, and but they're in a way, they digest their food like a bird does. Their food first goes into a gizzard, which is a thick muscular organ that, you know how birds need to have some stones and gravel or grit in their gizzard? And it's like their teeth, because if you notice, birds don't have teeth. Worms don't have teeth either. So they don't have any way of chewing their food. They swallow it, and then it goes into the gizzard, and that's where they chew it. And they chew it with this. It grinds around in this muscular, it's like a stomach, but it grinds the grit, and they keep this grit in there. So you need some of it in here, because they will go through this bedding, and so you just...
If you added just the core, you'd have to add that.
And then you add this too, yeah. And you add some sand, and that gives them some grit.
You have that coir, whatever you call it.
Coir.
And do you put paper too?
You can add paper, you can add leaves. I think the more diversity you have in there, the better. I also like to add, this is also some compost, just to give them some nutrients and soil sort of texture to the bin.
So they feel at home.
Pardon me?
So they feel at home?
Yeah, so they feel at home. Just to give them a bedding with some soil and so on. Remember, they don't like light, so they're going to want to go as deep as they can. And, of course, the other thing they need is you want it to be moist. You don't want these things to be dried out so that they're uncomfortable. They want to be wet in there. And you just mix it around until it's like a wet sponge type of feeling to it. Mine has a drain on the bottom so I can put water in and it drains out, and then I get the vermiculture tea, it's called. And that's like, how would you put this? Worm poop tea. And you apply that to plants. And we don't get huge quantities of that, so I use that on houseplants, because we just get small amounts for houseplants. And we put that in, and let me see, I think we should add some more here. And Julie was nice to bring along some of her friends with her. Has anybody ever heard the Herman the Worman story? Does anybody know Herman the Worman?
No.
No. Okay. Well, Herman the Worman's a great kid's story.
I never heard that.
Herman the Worman?
No.
My kids loved it.
I like just saying it. Herman the Worman. Everyone
knows about that.
Pardon?
You've read the Diary of a Worm.
Diary of a Worm. Okay. Yeah, we're making a little bit of a mess here. But anyway, and I put in, you know, the sand. They'll find it. They'll move around. And they'll come across it as they move around in here. Because they need that grit in, for their gizzards. The worms that we use, somebody wrote me and said they were going to get night crawlers from a bait shop and use them in their worm bin. Not a good idea. They wanted to raise worms for fishing. They were obviously going after bass, not trout. And but what you really want are these guys.
Are those red wigglers?
These are red wigglers.
Red what?
Wigglers.
Red wigglers.
And as you can see, for fishing, they're kind of small. These are adults.
Yeah. Can I see? Yeah, they're all little wild. Oh, they don't have any way to go.
No, they're adults.
Let me see. No, but they're small.
Yeah. And these are smaller than your typical earthworm.
Say that sentence again, please.
Huh?
Say that last sentence.
They're smaller than earthworms.
What kind of worms are these?
Red wigglers.
I have those in my compost pile.
Yep.
You think, yeah.
You can't keep them out if you have a good
compost. It rained and there were worms everywhere. Oh yeah, they're very skinny. Were those earthworms?
Those are earthworms. You've really got, oh, okay, thanks for coming. Yeah, don't get in trouble. You've got three kinds of worms. I mean, there's a couple hundred species of worms. But you've got three kinds of worms. You've got night crawlers, that are big, and they live 5 or 6 feet deep in the soil. And they come up as predators.
And they're not the ones we're supposed to use?
No. Because they like to be 5 or 6 feet deep. And your bin isn't going to be 5 or 6 feet deep. And you're going to put your food in on top, and they're not going to want to come up and get it. Earthworms live 1 or 2 feet deep, and they're getting the stuff that's coming down from the surface after it's worked its way down. These guys are the worms that live right under the surface. If you go out in the woods and you move some leaves aside, if it's moist and it's warm and good conditions, this is what you'll find under the leaves.
Then how is it in any of the places they offer earthworms, not red wigglers?
Well, for fishing?
No, for worm bins. No.
I don't know. No. It should be red wigglers is what any earthworm place, I mean any worm bin place sells is going to be red wigglers. There's several species of them, but they're all red wigglers, and they're very small, and they're the kind of worms that like to live right near the surface, because that's where you want them. You want them near, you don't want worms that need 3 feet of soil. You want worms that are happy right near the surface. And so, and these are the worms that get the first stuff. They're the ones that get the fungus and the bacteria and the decaying organic matter on the forest floor. They're the ones that pick it off first. And they break it down, and it goes down to lower worms eventually. But you again, think of the way nature does it. You're setting up a system here that is essentially like the surface soil somewhere. And so you want to have the worms that live near the surface. Can I put them in?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm in.
And
you're probably happy to be home, back in a home.
Now, where did you get them from?
Actually, these
were these ones from that we had?
Yeah, and then I've been taking care of them since last semester. So now they're home. I still have, I mean, I didn't bring them all.
So would you just go to your worm bin and put them
up? I went to my worm bin, I turned it upside down onto a tarp, and they all go to the bottom, and I scooped the composted stuff away and found the worms, and I kind of got them out, and I kind of dug them out, so they're mostly worms.
Now there's light in here, so these worms, they had no choice in here because they had nowhere to go.
But that's where they were.
Now they're in here, they're going to head straight down because they do not like light. Light to a worm is bad news. They don't have eyes, they can't see it, but they can sense it.
I actually had it inside that black thing, so it's all right.
Yeah. So you want to keep them in, and that's one of the reasons, well, why don't they just crawl out? Well, to crawl out, they have to come into the daylight, and they don't like that.
Yeah,
that's bad. That's where the predators live. That's where the birds are, and insects that eat worms, and salamanders and frogs and everything. So they will try not to come out. They don't like that at all. They'll always be down. So when you're feeding them, if you put this in, do you mind if I feed them?
Go right ahead. Please do.
What I tend to do is I put a little bit. You can come over and see.
Where'd they go?
Yeah, they're gone.
They already went to the bottom.
They're heading down. Didn't you hear it? Dive, dive, dive.
you put the chrysa.
This is raw, so it's going to take them longer to get to that. This is cooked skin from squash. They love that. They love melon and squash skin. Oh, they love it.
Watermelon in there, and it was like devoured.
Banana peels, put it in.
No garlic,
cut onion
and
piece, little piece.
You can't put onion and garlic in there?
Onion and garlic, they don't like
onions so much.
Can you put fish in there?
I just use veggies. I don't put any meat.
Just plant material, I wouldn't.
Can you see all right?
Sorry. And they'll eat through the filter?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So why don't you get those and put them in a big outside one, no?
This is
you can.
What I got it from the bottom, but this is what they turned.
So would you say no onion, no garlic?
This is a little wetter than I like. I should have put some more bedding in it to dry it out. And the worms are all at the bottom because there's worms in this one too. But this.
And they'll come to where the food is. They'll smell it. And so if you were to just put it over here, all of it, they'll come there. Now what? Since we're just starting this, I'm kind of putting food everywhere. But once it's going, and there's some more coffee. They love that. Gets them up in the morning.
But
I tend to rotate, and I put my food in this corner one day, and then a couple of days later, I'll put it in this corner, and then this corner, and then this corner, and then I just keep rotating.
That's the problem.
Just to keep it around, in different locations.
What are you doing this after? Do you put it outside in your bin?
That's a lot.
I'm sorry?
No, how long does it take to, for this to become...
They eat twice their weight in food a day. So if you've got a pound of worms in there, which we didn't, if you had a pound, because normally they sell them by the pound.
Okay.
If you put a pound of worms in there, they're going to eat 2 pounds of food a day. They're big eaters, those little guys.
And if you don't have enough food?
They will slow down and they won't eat as much.
So they won't die?
They won't die, but they won't reproduce as much. The population will go down, and they'll adjust to the amount of food that you provide them.
But if you've got that.